Turn together to John chapter 6. As we look at the word together, let's pray together. This whole discussion that Yeshua, this discourse that Yeshua has been in, started because God the Father led Yeshua the Son to feed 5,000 people plus with 5 loaves and a few fish, multiplied supernaturally by the Father's design and plan. And that has led to the discourse that we've been considering. And we've come to the place in this discourse where once again we see objections raised. At first we saw Yeshua dealing with the crowd as they had come looking for him, trying to find him after he had fed them. And they were looking for more food, more physical food. And he began to challenge their motives in seeking him and talked about faith being the way to do the work of God. And then they confronted him with a question about a sign to prove that he was who he said he was. And then we saw became a bit more focused on probably Jewish religious leaders, perhaps sent to look at Jesus' ministry, Yeshua's life, consider this itinerant preacher. And in verse 41, the Jews complained about him, and they said to him, "I am the bread that came down from heaven, but we know your family. How is it that you say, 'I have come down from heaven'? How is it possible?" And there is, in that statement, a level of unbelief. And now we come to verse 52 today, and this same group, the Jews, these are unbelieving religious leaders, probably. And it's probably, if not in verse 42, at least in this verse, this discussion is happening in the synagogue on Shabbat. And the Jews therefore quarreled among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" And that word quarrel there, it's a very powerful and strong word, that there's a deep, deep unbelief. And it seems like this has become a settled conviction in their minds and hearts. Yeshua has already declared that he is the bread of life. And then he took it a step further in verse 51, which we looked at last week, when he said that, "I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world." And they are wondering, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? And then in response, verse 53, then Yeshua said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I have, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. He who eats this bread will live forever. These things he said in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. What on earth does that mean? For us to eat the flesh of the Son of Man and to drink his blood. That is shocking. And yet, if we look carefully at what Yeshua has been saying, then we come, I think, to understand more and more clearly. Now, he talked about giving my flesh for the life of the world. It is important for us to recognize the time in which he said this as well. Back at the beginning of chapter 6 and verse 4, it says, now the Passover feast of the Jews was near, just like us, in just less than a week. Passover is here. And it was perhaps in that close proximity that Yeshua is saying all these things. And saying these things helps us to understand that this season of time, what he is saying. We know from Scripture, in Leviticus chapter 17, it was very clear. It says, and whatever man of the house of Israel, of strangers who dwell among you, who eats any blood, I will set my face against that person who eats blood, and will cut him off from among his people. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that makes atonement for the soul. Therefore I said to the children of Israel, no one among you shall eat blood, nor shall any stranger who dwells among you eat blood. So God had forbidden the eating of blood. So we know that something else is going on here. Let's look at some of the verses that have already happened, that have already been spoken by Yeshua, some of the statements. Let's go back to verse 35. Yeshua said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. So in relationship to the bread of life and receiving this bread, he's speaking about coming to Yeshua and believing in Yeshua. And then let's look at verse 40. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. And so Yeshua is highlighting that this relationship with him involves seeing and believing, beholding and trusting. Now, verse 47. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. And then verse 48, I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that one may eat of it and not die. And then verse 51 we looked at, I am the living bread which comes down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. So, if we look particularly at verse 40, and tie that in with verse 54, look at the comparison. This is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes him may have everlasting life. Verse 54, whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. Verse 40, and I will raise him up at the last day. Verse 54, and I will raise him up at the last day. Yeshua is saying, not that we would physically eat his flesh, not that we would physically drink his blood, but he is pointing to the fact that he is giving his life as a sacrifice, and that it is coming to trust him in that sacrifice that he makes, that it is the source of life. To trust him as the one who gives life, the bread of life, the one who lays down his very life, his flesh and his blood. To trust him, to see and to believe him. That is what it means to eat his flesh and to drink his blood. Yeshua has been highlighting, John has been highlighting for us throughout his gospel up to this point, that this Yeshua is God in flesh, but that he came to die. In John chapter 1, verse 21, John the Immerser said, here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And in the Passover season, how does the Lamb of God protect us? The Lamb of God is sacrificed, and the blood was put on the doorposts, and the flesh was roasted and eaten. The Lamb of God, Yeshua, is pictured as a lamb, and that lamb would come to die. And in John chapter 2, verse 19, remember Yeshua was there and he cleaned the temple, and they were demanding a sign, and he said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Picturing the fact that there would be death involved in his life and resurrection. And in the conversation with Nicodemus in John chapter 3 and verse 14, Yeshua pointed out that picture in the Tanakh, that as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up. These pictures, these hints, if you will, highlight the fact that Yeshua is coming to give his life, that he comes as the son of Joseph, the suffering servant, first, before he comes as the son of David, the ruling conqueror, Messiah. Isaiah 53 pictures Yeshua as the suffering servant. Isaiah 53. Who has believed our report? To whom is the arm of the Lord being revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs, not his own. He has carried our sorrows, not his own. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, not his own. He was bruised for our iniquities, not his own. the chastisement for his peace, for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. This is the suffering servant. This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the bread of life. This is the one who gives his flesh and his blood poured out for us, that we might know rescue and healing and forgiveness. Yeshua was picturing sacrifice, the sacrifice of his life. Verse 60 of John chapter 6. Not only did the unbelieving religious leaders have trouble with what Yeshua was saying, but also some of his disciples. Therefore, many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, "This is a hard saying. Who can understand it?" When Yeshua knew in himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, "Does this offend you? What then, if you should see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life. But there are some of you who do not believe." For Yeshua knew from the beginning who they were who did not believe and who had betrayed him. And he said, "Therefore, I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted to him by my Father." From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. You see, they were not genuine disciples. They were curious people. They had a wrong view of what Messiah was to be like, and Yeshua did not fit their template. And when Yeshua began to talk things this way, when he began to talk his flesh and blood being given for the life of the world, drinking his blood and eating his flesh, that was it. They were gone. And they manifest their heart of unbelief by their choice and their action. You see, they had looked at Yeshua and that they had evaluated him. And they had decided he's not the genuine article. He's not the real thing. He's saying weird and strange things. Now, Yeshua would say this kind of thing throughout his ministry. In other gospels, the gospel writers very clearly talk about the parables of Yeshua. And particularly in the gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, that chapter that deals with many of his parables. In verse 10, it says that the disciples came and said to him, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" And Yeshua answered and said to them, "Because it has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. For whoever has, to him more will be given, and he will have abundance. But whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. Therefore I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand." There are many profound things about God that you and I don't necessarily understand. I think often of Job. As things happened in his life that didn't make sense, and God, it seemed, was silent for a long period of time, and his friends turned out to be not so good friends, and all of the things that they had to say about him. And in the simple, simplistic, glib, shallow, untrue answers to his dilemma. And Job, through his suffering, still held on to the relationship with God. The Lord has given, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And then, at the end of that book, God shows up. And God doesn't answer his questions. God asks a bunch of questions. Where were you? What about this? What about all my creation? Do you know how to do this? And after that encounter with God, God never answered Job's questions about his suffering. But God's character, God's revelation of himself was enough. And Job said, I put my hand over my mouth and I repent in dust and ashes. Mm-hmm. And he prayed for his friends and his intercession healed his friends whom God was saying, you're guilty. Mm-hmm. And in this case, God chose to restore Job and give him twice as much as he had before. God never explained what was going on. But through it all, God kept his servant. And Job saw him clearly enough to say, I can trust this God even though there are mysteries I don't understand. I can trust this God even though I go through the depths of the valley of the shadow of death. I can trust this God because his character is sterling and pure and good and right. And loving. I love Mary, Yeshua's mother, if you will. And she is a perfect picture for us, I think, of trusting God in the midst of things we can't understand. In Luke chapter 1, the first big challenge comes into her life. Verse 26. Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Miriam, or Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and considered what manner of greeting this was. And then the angel said to her, Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Yeshua. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Highest. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary had a question. She said to the angel, How can this be, since I do not know a man? And the angel answered and said to her, The Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore, also that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now, indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who is called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible. Mary didn't understand, but the explanation was adequate. And Mary said, Behold, the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. Yeshua is born. And in chapter 2, verse 19, after the shepherds had come, these strange group of shepherds come, say they were sent by a choir of angels, a host of angelic beings, that had told them about the birth of this child. And again, Mary didn't understand, but look at her response. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And then they took Yeshua to be circumcised, to be dedicated. And they were encountering wonderful things in the temple, and Anna and Simeon came up to them. Simeon spoke these incredible things about Yeshua. And in verse 33, after hearing all these things, it says, "And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him." They didn't understand, but they marveled. And then, verse 48, they had gone to worship. They had gone to Jerusalem. And Yeshua had stayed in the temple. And they had left and realized he wasn't with them. And then they came back and searched for him. And it had been several days. And in verse 48, it says, "So when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said to him, 'Son, why have you done this to us? Look, your father and I have sought you anxiously.'" 12 years old, Yeshua, being in the temple, asking questions and giving answers, and they were amazed at him. And his mom and dad were amazed too. What on earth was this 12-year-old boy doing? And Yeshua said, "Why did you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my father's business?" But they did not understand the statement which he spoke to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject to them. But his mother kept all these things in her heart. You see, this is the way to respond to circumstances we do not understand. When we encounter sayings that seem incredible coming to us from Yeshua, from God, when things happen that we don't understand, when he says things that we just aren't totally clear about, we can know that because of his righteous character, that he is faithful and true always, that even if I don't understand things right now, that I know enough about him that I can trust him with the mysteries, with the unknowns, with the things that are as yet unclear. But the Jewish religious leaders immediately didn't understand. Those who heard the parables and didn't understand and didn't hold it in their heart, they said, "Oh, he's nuts. He doesn't know what he's talking about. That's terrible. He's against the law. He's violating the law. He can't be from God." That was their conclusion in all of that. And these disciples that had been following him, and perhaps they enjoyed the bread or some of the stuff that was happening, popularity that had been going up into this moment in time. But then he started saying these things about his flesh and his blood and being the bread of life and coming down from heaven and all of that. And these disciples that were superficial left. Well, then Yeshua approaches the 12 back in John chapter 6, verse 67. Then Yeshua said to the 12, "Do you also want to go away? Or you don't want to go away too, do you?" And there's an expected no in the answer, but there's also that touch in Yeshua's heart. What about you? What about the 12? These ones that I have picked especially, what about you? And in verse 68, "And Simon Peter answered him, 'Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. You are the Holy One of God.
Hallelujah.
What did they see? They didn't fully understand. But Peter, speaking perhaps for the group, is declaring what they have come to know. They have seen, they have been with this man. They have watched him, they have listened to him, they have experienced him, and they have much, much more to experience. But they have come to see that this is the priceless treasure. This is the pearl of great price, the treasure hidden in the field. This is the one that is worth everything. This is the one we have left all to follow. Where else could we go but to him? He is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. When you and I have a really good friend that we've known for a long time, and they do something really crazy, do we throw them away? No. We go ask them about it. And we give them the benefit of the doubt because we've known them for such a long time. We've come to know their character and to trust their friendship. And then we ask and we find out the reason for what's going on in their life. You see, the key to a long-term relationship, an in-depth relationship with Yeshua, is to really know him. To really know him. And we cannot know him unless the Father enables us to. It is a supernatural thing. And when the Father stirs in our life and draws us to him, and we come to see who he really is, he is the treasure. The treasure, the one we have been looking for all of our lives. The one who gives us life. There is no one like him. No one. He alone is the living God who can give life. But even in this moment, Yeshua says in verse 70, did I not choose you? At the Father's guidance, I chose you, and yet one of you is a devil. He spoke of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for it was he who would betray him, being one of the 12. Even in the midst of the 12, there is one who is still hidden, whose heart is twisted, and who does not believe. And you see, that's a great tragedy, to be so close to the treasure, to be so close to the cornerstone and say it's just a piece of junk and throw it aside. To be so close, we have come to see Yeshua. Today we have come to see him in his glory, the bread of life, the one who gives his very life that we might have life, the one who is the Passover lamb that gives his life that we might be passed over. No judgment come upon us. All our sin removed, all the righteousness of God put upon us, that we find life that is everlasting and we will be raised up and resurrected at the last day. Where else can we go? We have found the treasure. Whom have we in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that we desire besides you. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for revealing your Son, Yeshua, to us. That in him is life. His life is the light of people. As many as would receive him, as many as believe in his name, to them you give the right, the authority to become sons and daughters of God. This day, Father, reaffirm in our hearts those of us who have chosen Yeshua, reaffirm that we have indeed chosen the most important one in all the universe and trusted in the one who gives life, your one and only Son. And if there is anyone here, Father, that has not made that choice, may this be the day that they choose to trust your word and your Messiah, Yeshua. We thank you, Father. We thank you for giving us this treasure. And we bless you and praise you for giving us life in Yeshua. In his name we pray. Amen.